إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، صفيه وخليله، أرسله بالحق بشيرًا ونذيرًا، وداعيًا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجًا منيرًا. أما بعد، فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. أما بعد، فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. My dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most kind, He sent prophets and messengers to people to show them the right way for salvation and true happiness in this world and in the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it part of His sunnah that the believers, they have to undergo a process of purification through trials and difficulties. And it is through that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets His servants closer to Him. And eventually and ultimately He will reward them with the prize of victory in this world, and in the hereafter they'll have the best reward saved for them. So life is full of trials. It has never been easy for believers and for prophets. They have faced difficulties and problems. Part of it is a loss of life. Loss of life, insecurity, fear, and worry. Sometimes the believers are starved through boycott, where the enemies, they would force an embargo on the community of believers. It happened during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All that I have mentioned, the great companions of Rasulullah, they all went through those difficulties. From being tortured, forced out of their homes, they had to seek refuge outside their country. They went outside Arabia. All Arabia, though big and vast it is, it wasn't, they couldn't find a place of security in it, so they sought refuge in Abyssinia, fil Habasha, where some of the Sahaba remained there for a few years. Because in the end, saving lives, it is one of the main maqasid of this deen. And a Muslim, he carries his identity with him. It is his faith, his belief, It is the ethics, the way of life he conducts wherever he can live with his, can live with his values and his deen. It is his place. A Muslim is not tied up to a piece of land. Otherwise, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would have not left Mecca, one of the holiest places. It contains the first house that Allah put for mankind. Yet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he lived the rest of his years as a messenger, and he passed away. Until today, his grave is in Al-Madinah. He established a mosque, and Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara became his homeland. But those great companions, after overcoming the difficulties, they did not stay in Al-Madinah seeking the blessings of being close to where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is buried. But rather they went out taking this beautiful religion, this ni'mah of Iman, taking this religion, and they wanted to share it with the rest of the world. And they went out in all directions. They went to Asia, they went to North Africa and to Europe. In the first 100 years of Hijrah, 30 years after his death sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Islam reached Central Asia, to the borders of China and North Africa, and in less than 100 years of Hijrah, Islam was in Spain, in Al-Andalus. And many of those companions are buried along this path of da'wah, along this path of conquest, taking Islam with them. One of them would request to be buried to the farthest land that the Muslims would reach. And I'm referring here to Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, the one who, in whose house Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent the first night in Al-Madinah. And he went out and joined the Muslim campaign. And at that time, Istanbul was not conquered. Muslims were knocking the doors of Byzantine and Istanbul. And he said, bury me near the walls of Istanbul, Constantinople. Abu Ayyub now, he is in Istanbul. There is a mosque in his name, Jami' Ayyub, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. My brothers and sisters, when we followed the deen of Allah and we implemented it in our life as a belief and also as a way of life, conducting our affairs according to Islam, whether public or personal, we became leaders in the world. And we brought civilization and saved people from the darkness of Jahiliyyah and brought them to the justice of Islam. Unfortunately, my dear brothers and sisters, we did not keep up to that. Some Muslims, they never thought that there'll come a day when we will lose a fight or a war with non-Muslims. So they settled and started enjoying dunya and become too relaxed with upholding Islam in their life. And instead of carrying and taking Islam furthermore, they stayed back and started enjoying dunya. And when dunya becomes your primary object, shaitan, that's when he thrives. And then people wanted to become, why should he be an emir and I am not an emir? So rivalry and division. In Spain we had in the beginning used to be part of the Khilafah, under the leadership of one Khalif in Baghdad. Now Andalus has been separated from the body of the Khilafah, and the new rivalries, a new Imarat. We have so many in Barcelona, there is an Emir. In Seville, there is an Emir. And in Cordoba, there is an Emir. And everyone wants to be an Emir. And some of them, they sought the help of Christians against their brothers. It was just a matter of time when Muslims' rule came to an end in that part of the world. That shrinking did not stop there. The focus on military campaign and ignoring teaching people, and the scholar's role became backward or insignificant. The Ummah ignorance started spreading within the body of the Ummah, and superstition became the norm, and people were living with fairy tales where they used to be leaders. So slowly they were shrinking, and the vacuum that is left by Muslims was filled by others, until they came and ran over our countries and divided us into small countries, and we are in that stage. Now, what is the way out of that? What is the way to regain the leadership of the world once again, to rebuild and to regain those glories? My brothers, there is no other way except to follow the way of a Salaf Salih, to follow the way of the early generation of Muslims, how they did it. As one of the Imams said, لن يصلح حال هذه الأمة إلا بما صلح به أولها, أو كما قال. Yani our state of affairs will not change unless we return to the path, to the source of our strength, and that is the Book of Allah, the Sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Implement their teachings in our life. Start leading our life according to the will of Allah, not according to our desires, and follow the easy way. That is the only way. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر لكم الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. My dear brothers and sisters, the other thing is the ignorance that has came and invaded the Muslims, that became prevalent, illiteracy and ignorance. We are ignorant of our own religion and our own history, and many of us do not know the extent of this Ummah, how spread out around the world, around the globe. And we started knowing about ourselves the way others tell us about ourselves. Instead of us discovering it, we are being told who we are. And my brothers, to reverse that, we have to give special attention to our boys and girls. Give them that which our grandparents did not have, our fathers and our grandparents did not have. Give them the true learning. Let them know their religion and know Al-Quran Al-Kareem, not only reciting it but understanding it. There are so many people who are hafiz of Al-Quran, but he cannot explain to you one ayah of the Quran. We need people who understand the Quran and implement the Quran in their life. The other thing is they need to know about the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the stories of those great Sahaba, those leaders who conquered the world, who set an example to the world, and know about our history, our glorious history, so that our youth and boys and girls get inspired and they have examples in front of them that they want to follow. Not instead of following football players or musicians or cricket players here and there. It's sad when I see boys and girls, all they talk is about the latest football player and the teams and scoring, and they know everything about cricket and about football. What do they know about those great people who changed the world? So we need to teach our boys the history, the glorious history of Muslims, of Islam. And let them see shining example. Where I want a young man to say, I want to be like Khalid ibn al-Walid. I want to be like Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu. I want to be like Mus'ab ibn Umair. That young man, the first ambassador of Islam. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him to teach the people of Medina. Or he would say, I would like to be like Mu'adh ibn Jabal, the one who sent him to Al-Yemen to teach people Islam. These are the kind of example. I want to be like Tariq ibn Ziyad, the one who conquered Al-Andalus. Instead, knowing about that football player or the actor, and it's a culture, it's a knowledge that has no benefit. Our children will never be of that generation that will change the world again. Unless they get inspired and to be proud Muslims, they know their identity, and when you send them to study anywhere in the world, they have no confusion. They take the knowledge and they'll be people who will do da'wah and walk among their peers without being hesitant or shy to say who he is. A proud Muslim, not an arrogant Muslim. A proud Muslim who understands the true meaning of Islam. دين الوسطية والاعتدال ليس دين التطرف. Not those extremist views. There are people who are trying to fill the vacuum in our youth. And because of the nature of the youth, they want to see things black and white, and they give them some ideas. Unfortunately, it has an Islamic wrapping, but the content is poisonous. The content is poisonous. It's only the wrapping is Islamic, but it is devastating. So we have to give special attention to our boys and girls. I know you are doing your best as parents. You are sending them to the best schools you can afford. And you are most, half of your savings, probably, or more of your savings is dedicated to your children's education. But what a secular education brings him if he does not have that Islamic knowledge and Islamic upbringing? My brothers, we want our boys and girls to be empowered, to be the best in academic, to be the best doctors, the best engineers, because the Ummah needs them. We need to have our own expertise. The Muslim Ummah should be self-sufficient in expertise. And I'll tell you from my personal experience. My brothers and sisters, probably many members of our community, they know I have asthma, like many people. And I have seen many doctors in the West, where I live. Wallahi, until one member of this community came and approached me, and he said, Brother Abu Uthman, I noticed you have a problem. And he said, I want you to visit me in my clinic. Wallahi, my dear brothers, in brief, this young man, this doctor, he's the best doctor I have met in my life. He understands, and for the first time I consider myself educated. And I thought I knew about this case and how to deal with it. But the way he explained it to me, the treatment he prescribed, wallahi, I've seen consultants. But a person like that, I have not met. And I was so proud that he is a Muslim. And no, do you know what? And he is also Kuwaiti from this country. It is something to be proud of. We have the expertise Do you know the difference between a Muslim doctor and non-Muslim doctor? A Muslim doctor, he does it with sincerity and he knows that Allah is watching him and he cares and he is doing it for Allah. And you know, he said, I do not want to be paid for anything. I said, brother, I can afford it. He said, no. I want to do it for the sake of Allah. These are how we want our boys and girls. We want them to be doctors, we want them to be engineers, the best the world can see. Unless we do that, our state of the ummah stays as it is. My brothers, I'll conclude my khutbah with one piece of news. It saddened me a lot. The Europol, the European police, have made a statement that 10,000 unaccompanied children from Syria, officially they declared them as lost. 10,000 unaccompanied children, their whereabouts is unknown to the official body, European police. 10,000 young Muslims, children belonging to Muslim families, boys and girls. My brothers, doesn't that touch you? Doesn't that make you, why do they have to go there? Why the Muslim Ummah could not find a place for them? Why didn't we get there first to bring those boys to our Muslim homes to take care of them? Why do they have to go to an unknown land? And yesterday, a woman was caught smuggling a 4-year-old child in a plane. Our children, these boys and girls I talked about, they are our hope and they are our future. Some of them are lost in the middle of a hostile environment that do not feel towards them like we feel for each other. I leave you with that thought. And I think you know the solution. If we the Muslims do not take care of each other, of ourselves, nobody will do it. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا واصرف عنا ما شر ما قضيت. اللهم لا تدع لنا ذنبا الا غفرته ولا ذنبا الا قضيته ولا دين الا قضيته ولا هم الا فرجته ولا مريض الا شفيته. اللهم لا تجعل بأسنا بيننا يا رب العالمين. اللهم وحد صفوفنا. اللهم إنا نسألك أن تؤمن أوطاننا وتحفظ لنا بلادنا وتستر عيوبنا. اللهم كن لنا ولا علينا. اللهم احفظ إخواننا المظلومين. اللهم انصر إخواننا المظلومين وكن لهم عونا يا رب العالمين، ووفقنا أن نكون عونا ويدا لهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم احفظ الكويت وجميع بلاد المسلمين يا رب العالمين، احفظها من كل الفتن ومن كل مكروه يا رب العالمين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.